So today we'll be learning introduction to organ transplantation, types of organ transplantation, graft rejection, immune suppressors, autoimmune diseases, and in that rheumatoid arthritis and multiple sclerosis. So before moving on to the next slide, I want to know what is organ transplantation for you all. Anybody? Just a vague answer. No particular definition. You might have heard organ transplant type from our parents who come here. So, who are we? Replacing organs. Yeah. So, replacing organs, that is what we know. But let's see what it is in medical world and medical procedures, how it is done. So, organ transplant is a medical procedure in which an organ is removed from one body and placed in the body of a recipient to replace a damaged or missing organ. So, we just cannot do organ transplant without any particular reason. Either the organ has to be damaged or it should be missing, or there has to be some kind of disease that has affected the organ, and that's when we do the organ transplantation. So it's a very huge process. It just can't be done overnight. You need listing, you need donors, you need a lot of factors to consider when you're doing organ transplantation. Organ transplantation is one of the great advances in modern medicine. Unfortunately, the need of organ donors is much greater than the number of people who actually donate. So there are a lot of recipients than people who donate organs. So we have a lot of, let's say, deficiency in finding donors. So what they are trying to tell is we have to find more donors and more than recipients. Like we have a lot of recipients who wants literally organs, and there are a lot of ethical issues that we have been facing in organ transplantation, like organ trafficking, or many such reasons like that. And also because there's a huge business behind this. So that's why we don't have so many donors as we have recipients. So you see this picture over here. So this is the first heart transplant performed in South Africa. Okay, so this was the first organ transplantation. So again, any rough idea of which organs we usually transplant?
Kidney.
Yes.
Liver.
Is it only organs?
Eyes.
Yeah, it's eyes only. Something we don't transplant in eyes. Cornea. So we transplant, as you said, heart, kidneys, liver, lungs, pancreas, intestine, thymus, and uterus. Next, moving on. So types of organ transplantations. So we have various types of organ transplantation. As you can see in this slide, the first one is autograft, second is allograft, third is isograft, fourth is xenograft, fifth is domino transplants, and sixth is ABO incompatible transplants. So the first one, autograft. So autografts are the transplant of tissue to the same person. So as I said, we just don't transplant organs, we transplant tissues, and cornea is also tissue. So we obviously transplant that as well. And we need a cornea transplant. And why do we do cornea transplant?
If that recipient's cornea is damaged.
Any reason why it should be damaged? Like, yeah. A lot of diseases, which is glycoma, is one such thing. Sometimes this is done with surplus tissue, tissue that can regenerate or tissues more desperately needed elsewhere. So, example, includes skin graft, grafts, vein extraction in CABG, etc. Sometimes an autograft is done to remove the tissue and then treat it or the person before returning it. So first we take out the tissue, we treat it, we see whether it is compatible with the recipient's immune system, and then we transplant. This cannot transplant like that. So examples include stem cell autograft and storing blood in advance of surgery, which is very common. So next is allografts or allotransplantation. An allograft is a transplant of an organ or tissue between two non-genetically non-identical members of the same species. What do you understand by this? Non-genetical, non-identical.
From any
type of person. Yeah, so what are the factors we have to consider when the person is not genetically related? Because we are learning immunology, we learned about antigens, antibodies, reactions, which Matt taught us yesterday. So any reason why, what would be the risk factor? Just a rough idea.
Compatibility.
Obviously, compatibility and for the liver what it is. Most human tissue and organ transplants are allografts. Due to the genetic difference between the organ and the recipient, the immune system will identify the organ as a foreign and attempt to destroy it, causing transplant rejection. So, surgeon flushing donated kidney is the niche. Transplant in Queen Elizabeth Hospital, Birmingham, England in 2006. So, allograft, when we are doing this particular transplantation, it can be either sourced from a living being or from a cadaveric source, that is, dead body. Incompatibility rules may be observed for all recipients. This means that anyone may receive receive a transplant of a type O organ and consequently type O recipients are one of the biggest beneficiaries of ABO incompatible transplants. While focus has been on infant heart transplants, the principles generally apply to other forms of solid organ transplantation. This is basically concerned with heart transplants. But also we can do it for other organs also, but we have to again check the blood type, RH, all of that. So next is graft rejection. So graft rejection, how can I use the board? So graft rejection is also as transplant rejection. Anybody? Transplant rejection, have you heard?
Recipient's body rejects the transplanted organ.
And why?
Because of some incompatibility.
Also because there are no, for the incompatibility. Why is it incompatibility?
Antigen.
Yeah, all of that. The immune system possesses a significant barrier for successful organ transplantation when tissue or organs are transplanted from one individual to another. Rejection is caused by the immune system identifying the transplant as foreign, triggering a response that will ultimately destroy the transplanted organ or tissue. The intensity of the immune response against the organ or tissue, also commonly referred to as the graft, will depend on the type of graft being transplanted and the genetic disparity between the donor and the recipient. As I said, so organ transplanted is not that overnight. There has to be a lot of procedures to follow, and one of this is compatibility, the genetic disparity, the genetic gap between the individuals. And sometimes what happens is after transplantation also they keep an observation period, like 42 hours or 72 hours, depending on the organ, to see if the body is going in rejection. So if the body is going in rejection, that means the person who played become fatal, so they remove the organ. Okay? So it's not like all the transplants are 100% successful. There's also a chance of going into rejection. It might be compatible by transplanting, or they might say, okay, this is fine to transplant. But we never know how our body will react when it's transplanted. So even that's a major cons, I would say, in organ transplantation. So in mechanism of graft rejection occurs when the recipient's immune system attacks the donated graft and begins destroying the transplanted tissue or organ. The immune response is usually triggered by the presence of the donor's unique HLA proteins. Do you remember what is HLA? It's a protein. I'll tell you what it is later. Which the recipient's immune system will identify as foreign. The degree of similarity between HLA genes of the donor and the recipient is known as histocompatibility. The more genetically compatible the donor and the recipient, the more tolerant the recipient's immune system should be of the graft. However, unless the donor and the recipient are genetically identical, as in identical twins, there will always be some degree of rejection. As well as non-self-HLA proteins, other surface proteins on the donor graft can also be identified as a foreign antigen antigen and immune response. So, so what happens is, of course, by transplanting we see all these compatibility factors like antigens, antibodies, whatever it is. So by transplanting I think it's not a problem, but when our body sees that this is a foreign organ, because all this while your antigens, your antibodies are used to one kind of organ and suddenly it gets destroyed. And now you're transplanting another organ where the antigens might not be familiar. So it starts attacking. So that's the major drawback over here. And that's how our mechanism also works. That's why we keep us in that observation period. And you also give some kind of immune suppressors in order to avoid graft rejection. The most, too much of, you know, when you're in a healthy situation, that time we give immune suppressors. And then unless they see the body is able to control it. So
2 minutes left.
Next is chronic rejection. So as chronic rejection, we all know by the word it's like the end stage of something. Repeated episodes of acute rejection can ultimately lead to chronic rejection of the graft and failure of the transplant. Chronic rejection commonly manifests as tearing of the tissue or organ, which can occur months to years after acute rejection has subsided. At present, there is no cure for chronic rejection other than removal of the graft. In acute, at least we do some kind of immunosuppression. Immune suppression is the reduction of the activation of efficacy of the immune system. Some portions of the immune system itself have immunosuppressive effects on other parts of the immune system, and immunosuppression may occur as an adverse reaction to treatment of other conditions. So obviously, whenever we are going any major surgery or transplantation or anything as such, it's not always that our immune system has to be compatible with it. It might get adverse reaction, it might be some kind of thing that our body won't support. But then obviously we have a lot of medical advancements that will help us subside. In general, deliberately induced immunosuppression is performed to prevent the body from rejecting an organ transplant. Additionally, it is used for treating graft versus host disease after a bone marrow transplant or for the treatment of autoimmune diseases such as systemic lupus erythematosus, rheumatoid arthritis or Crohn's disease. So rheumatoid arthritis will be studied. So next is autoimmune diseases. Anyone knows what is autoimmune diseases?
Our body's immune system starts attacking us.
Yeah. So to say alien, our immune system becomes our own enemy. Autoimmune diseases happen when the body's natural defense system can't tell the difference between your own cells and foreign cells, causing the body to mistakenly attack normal cells. Okay? There are more than 80 types of autoimmune diseases that affect a vital or autoimmune diseases. The immune system mistakes a part of your body like your joints or skin as foreign. It releases proteins called autoantibodies that attack healthy cells. So we have 80 autoimmune diseases. But you know what is the problem with the autoimmune diseases? Has no cure. They are only treated for 10 years. So there is no permanent cure for this. Some autoimmune diseases target only one organ, type 1 diabetes. Damages pancreas. Other diseases like systemic lupus, erythematosus, SLE or lupus can affect the whole body. Now we'll learn about multiple sclerosis. So anybody, you have heard about this thing, multiple sclerosis, what it is? No? Multiple sclerosis or MS is a potentially disabling disease of the brain and spinal cord. Or the central nervous system. In MS, the immune system attacks the protective sheath, myelin, but they are called myelin sheath, all these things, right? That covers nerve fibers and causes communication problems between your brain and the rest of your body. Eventually, the disease can cause permanent damage or deterioration of the nerve fibers. Signs and symptoms of MS vary widely between patients and depend on the location and severity of the nerve. So basically, this is a nerve dysfunction. And there is no proper nerve connection or nerve communication between your brain and the spinal cord. Of the nerve fiber damage to the central nervous system. So symptoms of multiple sclerosis. Common symptoms include numbness or weakness in one or more limbs that typically occur on one side of your body at a time. Tingling. Or itching kind of a thing. Electric shock sensations that occur with certain neck movements, especially bending the neck forward. Lack of coordination, unsteady gait or inability to walk, partial or complete loss of vision, usually in one eye at a time, often with pain during eye movement, prolonged double vision, blurry vision and vertigo.
Joints.
Rheumatoid arthritis